Announcements. We have so many announcements. So last weekend we had a successful day of service. So please see the table inside the family room during ONEG. There's flyers for all the organizations who were represented here. So we have this tomorrow. We have a table at Ferndale Pride, 9 Mile, across from, like in front of Western Market. So if you want to go have a nice walk, I know Bruce and Cindy are volunteering. Max has like taken on the role of heading this up. And so we have things to give away. And if any of you would like to go and hang out there for a little while and chat up the CHJ, that would be great. Program committee is going to be soliciting suggestions for new activities at upcoming ONEGs, so please be friendly to them and tell them, give them ideas of what you would like to see happening here. And speaking of ONEGs, we have a new program where you can sponsor an ONEG Shabbat to celebrate a special occasion. Like the one that Cindy and Bruce sponsored last weekend, and Fran and Shore are going to be sponsoring one coming up for Pride, which is the Pride service on June 16th. We have our annual meeting on June 20th. There's a new class starting Sunday, this Sunday, June 4th. Natan is teaching it, Messianic Movements in Judaism. It's in person only here in the library. That Sunday is at 10. Rabbi Jeff's classes are on hiatus for a couple of weeks while he's on vacation. Our Musar study group meets next June 15th, which is a Thursday morning at 11 o'clock. Daytimers have a pool party planned for Wednesday, June 21st. I'll be leading service tonight and next week, and we're going to look at the activist lives of Harold Kushner and Harry Belafonte. And like I said, we are Pride Month service. The guest speaker is going to be Professor Tim Retzlaff, who's going to speak on Stonewall, and that's June 16th. Annual meeting and potluck is June 20th. Come play with us on Tuesdays. Tuesdays, you can do gentle yoga at 11 o'clock in the morning with Karen Lutz, which is a lovely class, and we're really trying to build that one up. It would be so nice to see you. Yoga is so good for your balance, your strength, your flexibility. And then on Wednesday, there's a more energetic yoga class led by Connie Grossman. Both of them are members, and both of them are donating their time and expertise. So we would really like to support their efforts. And then we ask for a small donation for your participation. And then we have a lively Maj group that's been meeting on Tuesday afternoons at 1. There's a new beginner table that has started, so if you've been interested in learning or like to brush up your skills, you are all welcome. Our readers tonight are Bobby Slade, Lonnie Fleischer, Susie Friedman, Harriet Meza, and Ruth Kadish. And before we begin, Cindy and Bruce are going to be our candle lighters tonight. I forgot about that. So if you would please just take a moment, make sure your noise-making devices are turned off or to silent. Take a deep breath. Put yourself in this space with your mind. Let your mind join your body. And we begin. Yes. Yes. Deep breath means in and out. I didn't specify. Yeah. Where the world is dark with illness, let us kindle the light of healing. Where the world is bleak with suffering, let us kindle the light of caring. Where the world is dimmed by lies, let us kindle the light of truth. May kindling this flame inspire us to acts of goodness that illumine all the world. May the mitzvah of lighting our Shabbat candles remind us to sanctify life with the power of light.
The desire for spirituality in the sense of a dimension to life extending beyond the rational, a life dense with profound experiences, manifests itself in love, art, and faith. All three are mental, spiritual concepts with the power to lift a person out of routine and beyond the boundaries of the ego. Beyond an exclusive concern with satisfying bodily needs and appetites. Love for an individual or community, for a people or all humanity, evokes a feeling of rising to some higher level and spurs us to do things unconnected to any material advantage. It can even lead us at times to act to our material disadvantage. The feeling of being part of a family or community is one of the most basic expressions of solidarity with the other and the human need for a bond that comes with no strings attached.
Shabbat shalom, all.
Shabbat shalom.
Albert Einstein spoke of the meaning of things. There is a feeling of awe at the scheme that is manifested in the material universe. It does not lead us to take the step of fashioning a godlike being in our own image, a personage who makes demands of us and who takes an interest in us as individuals. There is in this neither a will nor a goal, nor a must, but only sheer being. For this reason, people of our type see in morality a purely human matter, albeit the most important in the human sphere. And thus he observed, from the standpoint of daily life, there is one thing we do know, that we are here for the sake of each other. Above all, for those upon whose smile and well-being our own happiness depends, and also for the countless unknown souls with whose fate we are connected by a bond of sympathy.
Look within yourself, you'll find it there. There's a place with wisdom that can guide us. There's a place where we know what's right or wrong. Where's the path to peace that we all long for? Yesh makom betochenu, yesh makom betochenu. Look within yourself, you'll find it there.
Neil deGrasse Tyson wrote, "We are all connected to each biologically, to the earth chemically, and to the rest of the universe atomically. There are many atoms in a single molecule of your DNA, as there are in the stars, typically galaxy. We are, each of us, a little universe." Carl Sagan put it this way, "The cosmos is within us. We are made of star stuff. We are a way for the cosmos to know itself."
The eminent biologist and author Rachel Carson wrote, Those who dwell as scientists or laymen among the beauties and mysteries of the earth are never alone or weary of life. Whatever the vexations and concerns of their personal lives, their thoughts can find paths that lead to inner contentment and to renewed excitement in living. Those who contemplate the beauty of the earth find reserves of strength that will endure as long as life lasts. There is symbolic as well as actual beauty in the migration of the birds, the ebb and flow of the tides, the folded bud ready for spring. There is something infinitely healing in the repeated remains of nature, the reassurance that dawn comes after night and spring after winter.
On February 14, 1990, as the first deep space probe Voyager, I left our planetary neighborhood for the fringes of the solar system. Engineers turned it around for one last look at its home planet, now 4 billion miles away. Carl Sagan wrote, "Look at that dot. That's here. That's home. That's us. On it, everyone you love, everyone you know, everyone you ever heard of, every human being who ever was, lived out their lives. The Earth is a very small stage in a vast cosmic arena. Think of the endless cruelties visited by the inhabitants of one corner of this pixel on the scarcely distinguishable inhabitants of some other corner. How frequent their misunderstandings, how eager they are to kill one another, how fervent their hatreds. Think of the rivers of blood spilled by all those generals and emperors so that, in glory and triumph, they could become the momentary masters of a fraction of a dot. Our posturings, our imagined self-importance, the delusion that we have some privileged position in the universe are challenged by this point of pale light. Our planet is a lonely speck in the great enveloping cosmic dark. In our obscurity, in all this vastness, There is no hint that help will come from elsewhere to save us from ourselves. There is perhaps no better demonstration of the folly of human conceits than this distant image of our tiny world. To me, it underscores our responsibility to deal more kindly with one another and to preserve and cherish the pale blue dot, the only home we've ever known. Wow.
Nasse shalom, shalom ba'olam, nasse shalom aleinu ve'akol ha'olam ve'imru shalom. Nasse shalom aleinu ve'akol
where we find strength and common purpose, we turn our minds and hearts toward all those who need our love and support, those who are ill, those who suffer pain of the body or spirit, those who are lonely, those who have been wronged. Tonight, we send well wishes to Ruth E. Goldman, Ruth Moltz, Rabbi Peter Schweitzer, Jim Walker, and anybody you're thinking of starting on this side of the room. We're all good. I would send well wishes to family friend Julie Anderson. May all who suffer know that they are not alone, that we are here. May they be healed quickly. May they experience a refuah shlema, a complete recovery, the renewal of their bodies and the renewal of their spirits.
Makom ha-kovach betochenu, mekorot ha-bracha mevrotenu. May the source of strength that dwells so deep within us help us find the courage to make our lives a blessing. And let us say shalom. Makom ha-kovach betochenu, makorot ha-bracha mevrotenu. May those in need of healing know refuah shlema, the renewal of body, the renewal of spirit, and let us say shalom.
In memoriam. You shall ask what good are dead leaves, and I will tell you, they nourish the sore earth. You shall ask what reason is there for winter, and I will tell you to bring about new leaves. You shall ask, why are the leaves so green? And I will tell you, because they are rich with life. You shall ask, why must summer end? And I will tell you, so that the leaves can die. Our thoughts turn to those who are no longer with us, our own loved ones, those whom our friends and neighbors have lost, the martyrs of our people whose graves are unmarked, and those of every people and nation whose lives have been a blessing to humanity. As we remember them, we meditate on the meaning of love and loss, of life and death. We honor the yard sites of these members of our community tonight: Helen Horenstein, Ida Crone, Xenia Lachowitz, Jacob Lichtman, Gussie Meyerson, Morton Moltz, and anybody that you may be thinking of tonight. We recall now our loved ones whom death has recently taken from us, those who died at this season in years past, and those whom we have taken into our hearts with our own. Yehi zichram livracha. May memories of them provide blessing. I ask you to stand if you are able to do so comfortably for the reciting of our humanistic interpretation of Kaddish. Nitgaval v'nitgadash ruach ha'adam. Let us dignify and ennoble all people in the spirit of our shared humanity. Let us acclaim the preciousness of life. Let us show gratitude for life by approaching it with reverence. Let us embrace the whole world, even as we wrestle with its parts. Let us each in our own way take up our share in serving the world and seeking truth. May our commitment to life help us to strengthen healing of spirit and peace of mind. May justice and peace permeate and comfort the house of Israel and all those who dwell on earth. And let us say, Ken Yehi, may it be so. Please be seated. So, I hope I don't confuse you more than those of you who maybe saw the movie, and those of you who didn't, I hope I don't bewilder you with what I say. But here goes. Everything, everywhere, all at once. Not only is this the name of a blockbuster movie that swept the Oscars this year, but it is also apparently the modus operandi of the Michigan Department of Transportation. And you thought you were coming to hear a talk on the movie. Well, I think I will just do a public service announcement, and I'll tell you which roads have no construction going on at the moment, and this talk will be very short. No, for real. I will talk about the movie and lessons that I learned. The underlying story is of an immigrant family who owns a laundromat. Evelyn and Waymond are a Chinese husband and wife with failed aspirations and dashed dreams of stardom and riches. Their daughter Joy is trying to find herself by rebelling against her parents and wanting to come out and be accepted as a lesbian. Evelyn's father sees his daughter, Evelyn, as a failure. The movie centers around an audit with the IRS agent played by Jamie Lee Curtis, who you will, as Joseph will say, you can hardly recognize. But isn't this a fear that we all have probably once a year just after the first quarter? So it really was a universal concept, especially for Americans. When the movie opens, we see Evelyn. She's sitting at her desk with mounds of paper and receipts, and she's scribbling notes and circling numbers, and she's trying to prepare for this IRS audit. She's all alone, and she's fearful of what is to come. Evelyn gathers all her receipts, and she goes with her family, her husband, her father, her daughter, to the audit, which is in a gray building with stereotypical bureaucratic-type agents working at their desks in drab cubicles. Evelyn and her family sit across the desk from Jamie Lee Curtis, who is imposing in her uber-stereotypical bureaucratic garb. So, see, it seems like a rather mundane movie, right? So what's all the hype? But when you add in the concept of the multiverse, and it gets complicated and chaotic. So I asked teens and 20-somethings what they thought about the movie. They enjoyed it because it was full of action and chaos. And then I spoke to older folks. They did not enjoy the movie because it was full of action and chaos. Except for one, Marsha Mumbrew. You can talk to her later. She loved it. So I myself have watched the movie twice. The first time I went to see it was with a friend. He'd heard about it, and he was really eager to see it. I knew nothing of the movie. I'd heard nothing about it. So I went with no predisposed notion of what I would see, whether I would like it, whether I wouldn't. I was wowed by the action and the chaos. But when I left the movie, I still had no idea of what I had just witnessed, besides a woman who was battling demons that had taken the form of an IRS agent and her own daughter. Sometime later, I asked that same friend what he thought the movie was about. He said it was about relationships and love. I said, really? How? The second time I watched the movie was many months later, after the Academy Awards, with another friend. And this is what she had to say about the movie as we watched it. This is horrible. This is stupid. This is the worst movie ever made. How did it win all of those awards? But by this time, I was looking for the relationship and the love, and it made much more sense. I found some wonderful nuggets of wisdom that I will share with you. First and foremost, have an open mind to ideas or experiences that you may not be used to. Be willing to suspend disbelief, whether it is the multiverse, classical music, or the Grand Prix. Be curious. Find out what it is that enthusiasts get out of it. You don't have to like it, but don't tell yourself going in that you're gonna hate it, because your body will tense and you'll feel pain. Many years ago, I watched a movie called What the Bleep. That one centered around quantum physics and the idea of a parallel universe. I was curious. When I began to think about it, I realized that it was not such a strange concept and that I could apply it to something that I have been doing most of my life. I've been watching the same soap opera for 45 years now. The Young and the Restless is my alternate universe. Eric Braeden has been playing Victor Newman for 43 years, and Melody Thomas has been playing his wife Nikki on and off, you know, because they're married, they're not married, they're married, they're not married, for 44 years. I have known these characters and these actors for 3/4 of my life. The Young and Restless has been my daily escape, with their world in Genoa City, Wisconsin, being my alternate universe. As they go through time parallel to me, mostly. Sometimes kids go off to boarding school and come back next year 10 years older, but most of the time, time marches on. Of course, this is on a much different level than the multiverse that they were presenting in this movie, but it did give me something familiar with which to relate. Next lesson, practice humility. Is it really so unbelievable that there are other universes out there? We were just talking about humility in our Musar study group. It may never happen that Earthlings can travel from one to the other, one universe to the other, by use of an app on a phone-like device that's going to shoot you here or there. But maybe there are beings out there who are smarter than us. Maybe they'll be able to do it first. It would be quite arrogant of us to think that we are the only planet in the only universe with life on it. So humility is something to think about. Stephen Hawking said, to confine our attention to terrestrial matters would be to limit the human spirit. We are just an advanced breed of monkeys on a minor planet of a very average star. But we can understand the universe, and that makes us something special. The next lesson comes from a character in the movie, Alpha Waymond. So remember, Waymond is the husband. There's Evelyn and Waymond. And the Alpha Waymond is the one who's the alternate husband, who's got the app on the phone-like device that can send Evelyn to these other universes to capture her powers. And and various powers. So he tells Evelyn, pay attention. When we leave this elevator, you can either turn left towards your scheduled audit, or you can turn right and go to the janitor's closet. What kind of a lesson is that? Well, we often come to the proverbial fork in the road as we travel through life. Often, one fork has a predictable outcome. For instance, Evelyn going to her audit appointment, she would likely be fined, have to pay some money, be intimidated for sure. However, the other requires some amount of courage and curiosity, because who knows what is behind the door of the janitor closet? So I just read yesterday an NPR story about a man in his 40s who had been estranged from his grandmother for 20 some years after his parents divorced. A few years ago, they were both at a family wedding. He noticed she was looking frail. He did not approach her there, but he later called her to ask if they could make cookies together. They did, but it was still awkward, but he stayed in touch. Then 8 years ago, they connected again. He was in a dark place, he needed support. So he reached out to Grandma Joy. They started on a mission to visit all 63 national parks together. Brad and his Grandma Joy, who is now 93, recently completed the last park visit in American Samoa. Not only did they meet their goal, but they healed their relationship. So that initial call from Brad to his grandma took courage. He could have made the easier decision to just let things remain status quo, but with courage and curiosity, he turned toward the unknown. He didn't know how Grandma was going to react. He didn't know if their relationship would work. So there is this lesson next. Make time for the people who matter, which is connected to the prior lesson. Many times in the movie, we hear Evelyn tell her husband, and more often her daughter, no time to wait today, no time, no time, any other time. I beg you, come eat and call me or do anything, but I'm too busy today, too very busy. So tied with this is the lesson to enjoy what you have at the moment in time. Alpha Wayman, that alternate husband, the one with all the wisdom, he says to Evelyn, I know you have a lot of things on your mind, but nothing could possibly matter more than this conversation we are having right now concerning the fate of every single word of our infinite multiverse. He continues, my dear Evelyn, I know you. With every passing moment, you fear you might have missed your chance to make something of your life. I'm here to tell you, every rejection, every disappointment has led you here to this moment. Don't let anything distract you from it. So profound. Evelyn had aspirations of being a famous singer, a novelist, a chef. She found herself watching laundry go round and round in a laundromat, feeling a failure. This is further symbolized in the movie about how we try to pile on too many things and miss the moment. This is symbolized by an everything bagel. The alternative daughter, who is also the evil antagonist in the movie, in these alternate universes, in the present, in our universe, she's just lost and rebellious and trying to find herself. In these alternate universes, she becomes the antagonist. And she tells her mom, Evelyn, you know, this is the alternate Joy. I got bored one day and then I put everything in a bagel, everything, all my hopes, all my dreams, my old report cards, every breed of dog, every personal ad on Craigslist, Sesame, poppy seed, salt. And it collapsed in on itself. Because you see, when you really put everything on a bagel, it becomes this, the truth. And when the world collapses around you because you have spread yourself too thin, you have nothing. And I think this is the truth Joy is talking about. This is a reminder that we cannot be everything, everywhere, all at once. Thich Nhat Hanh, in his book Good Citizen, says that when we water the seeds of mindfulness, happiness will appear. According to Buddhist psychology, we all have seeds of compassion and loving kindness in us. We also have the seeds of craving and violence. What seeds flourish are those that have been watered in our childhoods and by our ancestors. But I would go one step further and say that we have some responsibility for watering those seeds ourselves as well. So maybe if Evelyn had spent more time nurturing her relationships with her husband and her daughter instead of ruminating on her failed aspirations of being a singer, a novelist, and a chef, she would find happiness even as a laundress. The directors, Daniel Scheinert and Daniel Kwan, say that in making this movie that they talked a lot about what it's like to have grown up with the internet and how that exacerbated the typical generational divide. What it feels like for everyone, no matter how old or young you are, to live right now with the internet. So one of the key metaphors was just that, what it's like to scroll through an infinite amount of content, which is something that we're all doing way too much. Which is why there is so much action in the movie, so many images coming at you in quick succession, such quick movement from one verse to another, from one scene to another. The movie is about finding each other in a very noisy world, because right now, everyone's struggling to figure out how to do that. We see this come to light here by way of contrast. In the midst of all the chaos, of the quickness of action, the martial arts, the noise, the absurdities, the verse where the people have hot dogs for fingers. And so all of a sudden, we get this scene. And Felicia, if you hit the space bar. No music, nothing, but two rocks representing Evelyn and her daughter Joy on a hill, having a conversation via subtitles. Nothing. It is silent. It is serene. And it's here where Joy tells her mom that they are in a universe where the conditions were not right for life to form. She says that most of them, most universes are like that. It is here that we see a real connection between Evelyn and her daughter Joy. Without all the noise and the chaos, they can connect and communicate. It is here that Evelyn apologizes to Joy for ruining everything. She says she feels stupid. And Joy tells her mom, "We're all stupid, small, stupid humans. It's like our whole deal. For most of our history, we knew the Earth was the center of the universe. We killed and tortured people for saying otherwise. That is, until we discovered that the Earth is actually revolving around the sun, which is just one sun out of trillions of suns. And now, look at us, trying to deal with the face that all of that exists inside of one universe out of who knows how many." Stephen Hawking says, Felicia, you can punch it again, thanks. Stephen Hawking says, "Look up at the stars and not down at your feet. Try to make sense of what you see and wonder about what makes the universe exist. Be curious. And I will add to that, be present and water your seeds of compassion and happiness." Thank you.
Peace be with you wherever you go.
with you wherever you go. Love be with you whatever you do. Love be with you till we meet again. Love be with you, my friend. Joy be with you wherever you go. Joy be with you whatever you do. Joy be with you till we meet again. Joy be with you, my friend. Shalom Aleichem, shalom, shalom. Shalom Aleichem, shalom, shalom. Shalom Aleichem, shalom, shalom. Shalom Aleichem, shalom.